Good afternoon. The main topic of this talk is going to be on new materials and new devices to push the performance of electronics forward. We are probably at the most exciting time for electronic devices in the last 30 years. And that's because of the combination of the new materials, new applications, new technologies. They are all coming together to bring new challenges, but also new opportunities. And that's what this talk is going to be about. And of course, I would like to first of all thank the work of my students, Dong Sup Lee, Han Wang, and Alan Su for being the ones actually doing the work that I'm going to be talking about today. So for the last few years, high frequency and high power applications have been driven the development of new semiconductors and new materials and new technologies. What we have seen more recently is that there is a new array of applications that are pushing the limits of electronics in completely new directions. For example, flexible electronics is not only good enough to have high frequency and high power. There are many applications that require a flexible form factor or the ability to integrate everything in a transparent environment. And finally, another very important application is to be able to provide high performance electronics, high frequency electronics, but over very large area. And conventional materials are not very well suited to basically provide this new functionality. In my group at MIT, we actually work on two new materials that we think are going to be very, very attractive in the next few years in order to push the limits of electronics along the directions that we were describing before. And these are the materials and devices I'm going to talk about today. First of all, we will be talking about gallium nitride transistors and their application for very high frequency and very high power electronics. Second, we will be talking about graphene, a really amazing nanomaterial made of only one atom thick, a layer of carbon, which is allowing us to go to flexible electronics, transparent electronic systems, very large area, etc., etc. So this talk is going to be divided between these two materials. And here we have the different topics that we will be talking about. But let me start with gallium nitride. Nitride semiconductors are a relatively new family of semiconductor materials, which have experienced a tremendous development for the last few years, focused mainly on solid-state lighting. It's the key material if we want to have blue LEDs, white LEDs, blue laser diodes, etc. But actually, it also has really outstanding properties for electronic applications. For example, it has very high electron velocity, 3 times higher than silicon. The thermal conductivity is also excellent. In some of the nitride semiconductors, the thermal conductivity can be 2 or even 3 times higher than silicon. The carrier density is typically 3 times higher than silicon also. And finally, what is really important for high power applications, they have really high critical electric field, which allows much higher breakdown voltage for a given device dimension, typically 10 times higher breakdown for a given geometry. And all these properties basically allow really unprecedented device performance. And because of this, gallium nitride has been used in many different applications, all the way from RF power amplifiers to MEMS devices taking advantage of the very strong piezoelectric properties of gallium nitride, to high temperature electronics, as well as optoelectronics, hydrogen generation, etc., etc. In this talk, we will be focusing on pushing the performance of gallium nitride electronics and transistors. And the main motivation for that can be seen in this plot where we show breakdown voltage as a function of current gain cutoff frequency, or FT, for different semiconductor materials. Here we have a silicon devices in black, gallium arsenide devices in orange, indium phosphide-based devices in blue. And the important thing to keep in mind in this plot is that different material systems allow you to have a different breakdown for a given operating frequency. But then, as we increase the operating frequency, the breakdown drops more or less in the same way, no matter what material system you have. So if we look at gallium nitride is shown here in green, and because of the very high critical electric field of this material system for a given operating frequency, for example, 100 GHz, we can get almost one order of magnitude higher breakdown voltage than indium phosphide based devices. The goal of our group is to push the frequency performance of these devices to higher and higher frequencies, as shown here in the arrow, while keeping the factor of 10 improvement in breakdown voltage. In order to do that, our group at MIT is focusing on indium aluminum nitride, gallium nitride transistors. And here we have the diagram of the simplest device you can think of. It is typically grown on silicon carbide to be able to solve the large lattice mismatch between gallium nitride and silicon carbide. We introduce a relatively thick layer of gallium nitride buffer. Then we grow a 1 nanometer thick aluminum nitride layer and the indium aluminum nitride barrier, typically 7 nanometers. And this structure is grown by our collaborators at the company IQE, who have a really excellent material in gallium nitride on silicon carbide. So basically, once that we have the material that we get from IQE, we fabricate the devices, source, drain, ohmic contacts, then the gate, and then we passivate the device with a very thin layer of aluminum oxide. The reason why we use indium aluminum nitride instead of aluminum gallium nitride as the barrier material is because the polarization difference between indium aluminum nitride and gallium nitride is much larger than between aluminum gallium nitride and gallium nitride, which allows us to have much higher charge density in the channel. So here we have the charge density as a function of the thickness of the indium aluminum nitride material in blue and the aluminum gallium nitride barrier in red. And what we see is that for a given thickness, for example 7 nanometer, we can get almost 2 times higher charge density when we use indium aluminum nitride than when we use aluminum gallium nitride. So that allows us to have much lower access resistance in our indium aluminum nitride transistors, which is going to enable us to go to higher frequencies. Also, with indium aluminum nitride, we can have much thinner barriers, in this case 7 nanometers, which significantly reduce the short channel effects. And in that way, we don't need to use gain recess to approach the gate to the channel. And finally, indium aluminum nitride is actually lattice match to gallium nitride, which has the potential to improve reliability. So this is the material system that we are going to use in our devices. However, our goal was to try to increase the frequency performance in gallium nitride transistors as much as possible. And here we have some devices reported in the literature where we have frequency performance, FT, as a function of gate length, LG. And here we have the value for different values of electron velocity, 1.5 10 to the 7 centimeters per second, 2 10 to the 7, and 2.5 10 to the 7 centimeters per second. And what we see is that all the devices reported in the literature show much lower performance than what we would expect from the theoretical value of the electron velocity. Theoretically, gallium nitride should have a peak electron velocity of more than 2 10 to the 7 centimeters per second, but all the transistors have FTs much lower than what those values should give us. So we have spent quite a lot of time in our group trying to understand the origin of this difference between the experimental FT performance and the theoretical values that we should be getting. And in order to do this, we've done a small signal analysis of the transistors and extracting the different elements in the small signal equivalent circuit. And when we do this to one of our state-of-the-art devices, in this case with a gate length of 200 nanometers and a barrier thickness of 25 nanometers, here we have how the gate-to-source and the gate-to-drain capacitance change as a function of frequency, and how the transconductance and the output conductance change as a function of frequency as compared to the theoretical value shown with the blue dots. And what we can see is that both capacitances actually behave just as expected from a theoretical point of view. However, the transconductance, the RF transconductance that we measure in these devices, is much lower than the transconductance that we would expect DC measurements. And that is actually the reason why the FT of most of the devices reported in the literature is much lower than what we would expect based on the electron velocity. In order to solve this problem, we've been able to develop a plasma treatment technology that actually fixes this transconductance collapse. And this was developed by my student Will Chung, and later on further optimized by Dong Sop Lee. So what we have here is the transconductance as a function of frequency, the expected value, as well as the RF small signal value after different treatments. This is as grown. This is after a chlorine-based plasma treatment that we apply under the gate region right before depositing the gate. This is a CF4 plasma treatment and an oxygen plasma treatment. And what we see is that when we use either CF4 or oxygen, we are actually able to remove this drop in the transconductance from DC to RF. So a fluorine or an oxygen plasma are really, really useful to make sure we use all the transconductance in these devices. And actually, we've been focusing on the oxygen plasma. And when we do an oxygen plasma, what we see is a very important improvement in the frequency performance of a device. So here we have the current gain cutoff frequency, FT, as a function of gate length in devices without a plasma in black and devices with an oxygen plasma treatment. And as we can see in this plot, for a given gate length, when we apply the oxygen plasma, we get a significant improvement in the frequency performance. And in a 30 nanometer gate length device, we got an FT of 245 gigahertz, which was the highest FT reported at that time. But even though this device performance is very exciting, it's significantly been limited by short channel effects. In these 30 nanometer devices, we can see that we have a very important drain-induced barrier lowering. Here we have the drain current as a function of the gate voltage, VGS, this should be VGS, for two different VDS voltages, 1 volt and 5 volts. And we see that we have a very large D-volt as well as a very poor sub-threshold slope. In addition to that, we have a very important output conductance in these very short channel devices. So in these early indium aluminum nitride transistors, short channel effects cannot be ignored, even though the barrier thickness is only 7 nanometers. To overcome the short channel effects, we've developed an indium gallium nitride back barrier structure, as shown in this device diagram. And basically, the introduction of only 3 nanometers of indium gallium nitride back barrier introduces a very significant conduction band discontinuity, which creates a quantum well like channel in our gallium nitride transistor. And this quantum well-like channel that we are able to fabricate due to the polarization-induced electric field in the indium gallium nitride back barrier is very important to improve the short channel effects. So here we have the D-ball as a function of gate length. For devices without back barrier, the open dots, as well as devices with a back barrier in red. And we see that we are able to significantly improve the D-ball, especially in devices below 100 nanometers. Also, the output resistance increases by at least a factor of 2. Here we have the output resistance in devices with back barrier in red compared to devices without back barrier, the open dots. And due to the improvement in the short channel effects, we were able to significantly improve the frequency performance of these devices. And we were able to go from 245 gigahertz in devices without back barrier to 300 gigahertz when we incorporated the 3 nanometer indium gallium nitride back barrier. And this is currently the state of the art in high frequency gallium nitride transistors at this gate length. And actually, even though these results are very promising, we believe that there is still large room for improvement. And we believe that in the near future, we should be able to take these devices to more than 400 gigahertz by basically reducing the barrier thickness a little bit and reducing the gate length. And 500 gigahertz device operation should be possible in the near future. So we have now a device technology that can go to very high frequencies while maintaining a very large breakdown voltage, typically well in excess of 20 volts. However, there are many applications that, in addition to power and in addition to frequency, require new functionality. Specifically, there is a lot of interest in flexible electronics or in transparent electronics. And finally, very large area electronics that we can use to cover entire aircraft if necessary. And the problem with gallium nitride is that if you try to use it in flexible electronics or in transparent electronics, it breaks. And that is a big problem for gallium nitride. It has excellent performance from the high frequency point of view, but it cannot be used in many of the exciting new applications that are coming these days. And to serve these new applications, our group is working on graphene. Graphene is a truly amazing material. It's the thinnest material you can think of. It's just made of a single atom or thick layer of carbon arranged in an hexagonal lattice, as shown here in this figure. And there has been a lot of excitement in this new material due to the amazing properties that it has. So here we have the number of papers written about graphene as a function of time. And we see that starting in 2005, there has been an exponential increase in the number of papers. Also, last year, the Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded to the two scientists in the University of Manchester who isolated graphene for the first time and did the first electrical characterization. And organizations and countries all around the world are starting very large research initiatives on graphene. This is all happening because of the really outstanding properties of graphene. As I said, it's the thinnest material that you can think of. It's just one atom thick, but it's also the strongest one. It's 5 times stronger than steel and much lighter. Graphene is also a semi-metal. What that means is that it conducts current as well as the best metal, actually even better under some circumstances. But also we can modulate the carrier density by changing the gate voltage. So it can be modulated like in a transistor. Also, the electrons and holes have extremely high mobilities, typically 100 times higher than silicon. And graphene is also the best heat conductor that we know of in the plane, and one of the worst conductors you can think of out of the plane. So again, new functionality, new properties for new devices. And in general, what is really interesting about graphene is all the new physics that this material brings to the table that allows new advanced devices. So we believe that graphene has the potential to revolutionize a wide variety of fields, all the way from electronics to material science to chemistry, etc., etc. But in our group, we are electrical engineers, and we are very interested in the specific properties of graphene for electronics. And I've summarized some of them in this slide. First of all, this material is a zero band gap material where the conduction band and the valence band are touching each other at a single point, which is called the Dirac point. And when you make a transistor as the one shown here in the bottom right corner of this slide, we see that we can change the Fermi level in the device as we change the gate voltage. And as we change the Fermi level, you can go from the Fermi level being deep into the valence band, all the way to the Fermi level, going all the way to the conduction band. And what that means is that in the same device, in the same material, you can induce holes, as in this case, in which case, if you measure the resistance between source and drain, the resistance is very low, or you can induce electrons when the Fermi level is in the conduction band. So this is actually very, very exciting because it allows you new flexibility in new devices. And you can look into that as a function of resistance, or you can look into this as a function of current, as a function of gate voltage, where you see the traditional V-shaped transfer characteristic of graphene devices, which is used in a wide variety of devices. But also because it's a one atom thick, it allows excellent electrostatic confinement. The electrons are confined to a single layer of atoms. And that is, again, very suitable for very high frequency devices. And one of the most exciting properties from our point of view for graphene is its very simple integration. Imagine we have a fully fabricated silicon chip, as the one shown schematically here in the picture. We have the silicon transistors and the interconnections. You can very easily transfer a layer of graphene on top. And then once that you have the graphene on top of the fully fabricated silicon chip, you can pattern devices and fabricate graphene transistors, graphene chemical sensors, graphene detectors, all at room temperature in a fully fabricated silicon chip. And this integration is extremely exciting for new applications. And this can be integrated on a silicon substrate, but it can also be integrated on flexible and transparent substrates. And here, for example, we have a thin layer of plastic where we have transferred graphene and we have fabricated some chemical sensors on it. And in addition to all these truly unique properties of graphene, graphene has excellent transport properties with an extremely high electron and hole mobility as well as carrier velocity. So these are the properties that we are using in our devices. But before I describe the devices that we are making on graphene, let me tell you a little bit about how we get graphene. The easiest way to get graphene is actually from graphite. Graphite can be thought of as multiple layers of graphene, one on top of each other, just like a deck of cards is made of many different cards. So the easiest way to get graphene is just by taking the top layer of graphite. And that's actually how graphene was isolated for the first time. You take graphene, you take graphite, and you take adhesive tape, scotch tape, and you press the scotch tape against the graphite. And if you are very lucky, a few flakes of graphite will be transferred to the scotch tape. And this is a picture of the scotch tape with the graphite flakes on top. Then you press the scotch tape against a silicon wafer and you remove the scotch tape very carefully. And this is what you get, the silicon wafer with a few particles or flakes of graphite. And if you look closely, you can see that in some regions, the flakes are thinner than in others. And in the places where the graphite is the thinnest, it's actually a single layer of graphene. This is just one atom thick layer of material. Slightly darker color means that you have bilayer graphene, and darker color indicates few or multiple layers of graphene. This is how graphene was first isolated, and 90% of the physicists in the world are still working with this kind of graphene and making devices in this kind of graphene. However, this way of making graphene is not good enough for engineering, where you need very large area graphene devices, and you need to be able to fabricate many devices at once. So in our group, we are not using this exfoliated method. We are actually using graphene that is grown by chemical vapor deposition of graphene on a metal substrate. And the main steps are summarized in this slide. We start with a copper foil that we introduce at high temperature in a furnace in the presence of methane. At high temperature, the methane breaks and the carbon goes to the surface of the copper layer, and when you cool down, it forms a single layer of graphene as shown schematically in this picture. But then if we want to make graphene transistors, we need to somehow remove the copper underneath because it's short-circuiting the entire graphene material. To do that, we spin coat on top a layer of PMMA, and then we can etch the copper chemically with copper etchant, and finally we clean it with HCl. So we use copper etchant and then HCl. And then we can transfer the graphene to any arbitrary substrate we want. This can be a silicon wafer or sapphire, diamond, piece of paper, plastic, etc. And finally, we remove the PMMA as shown here. So this is the material that we are going to use in our devices. And a very similar process can be scaled up, and these are images from a paper by Samsung Electronics where they were able to grow by a similar process a single layer of graphene that is 30 inches in diameter. And this is, I think, really amazing picture. It's really a nanomaterial, a nanotechnology going to the macro scale, 30 inches in diameter. And using this kind of material, we can make transistors. And this is a top view of one of our graphene devices with the gate electrode here, the drain, and two source electrodes. And we fabricate these devices on different substrates. In this case, sapphire or a boron nitride. And here, we have the frequency performance of these devices. And basically, depending on the substrate that we use, either sapphire or boron nitride, we are able to improve the frequency performance quite significantly. And in a device with roughly 200 to 300 nanometers of gate length, we can get FTs in the 30 gigahertz range for extrinsic performance. So once that we have these devices, the question is, what can we do with them? And our group is working on many different applications. The only one that we are not pursuing at the moment is electronics, mainly CMOS electronics. And the reason for that is because graphene doesn't have a band gap. So it is very difficult to pinch these devices off. Here we have the drain current as a function of the drain voltage for the typical graphene device. And we see that it doesn't pinch off. And this is a big problem for digital electronics. So we are not working on digital. But we have a lot of applications for RF devices. One of those applications is to use graphene in frequency multipliers. Basically, we want to introduce a low frequency signal at the input, typically a few hundred megahertz, and we want to get much higher frequencies at the output. And this is the circuit that we are using for this application. We have a graphene transistor. We introduce a low frequency signal at the gate of the device, and we get a high frequency signal at the output by taking advantage of the ambipolar properties of graphene. When we introduce a sinusoidal signal here, we see that positive voltages at the input give us an electron current at the output. Negative gate voltage gives us a Hall current at the output, but always in the same direction. So when you go from positive to negative at the input, you go from Hall to electron current at the output, effectively multiplying the frequency of the signal. So we've demonstrated this at quite high frequencies. We've introduced a signal at 8 gigahertz, and at the output we got 16 gigahertz signal in a very efficient manner. We can also use graphene devices to make oscillators. And here we use a graphene power amplifier with a feedback network, as shown here, to basically induce RF oscillations. And here we got a clear signal at the output of this graphene oscillator at 72 megahertz. And the oscillating frequency is given by the feedback loop in this circuit. We can also use graphene devices for mixers and modulators. And here we have a graphene transistor that we are using to demodulate a radio signal modulated with AM modulation at 10 megahertz. And we are demodulating it with a 10 megahertz a reference signal. And we connect the output of the graphene device to a speaker. And let me see if this works. Yeah, the sound doesn't work, but basically what happens is that the graphene is able to effectively demodulate the radio signal, and we can get very clear audio signal at the output. And the advantage of using a graphene mixer instead of a conventional FET-based mixer is that because of the highly symmetric transfer characteristic of graphene devices, the output power spectrum of this mixer is much cleaner than the conventional FET mixer. So, very good in terms of noise and power efficiency. We can also use graphene to make digital modulators. In this case, this is an example of a phase shift keying modulator made of graphene that we are using to basically fabricate RFID tags and Bluetooth systems, etc., where we are able to encode information in the phase of the signal, etc., etc. So many different new circuits. But what I would like to highlight is that not only you can get many new circuits, but you can make them in a completely new form factor. You can make them on a flexible, transparent a substrate, or you can integrate them in fabrics, textiles, piece of paper, etc. So graphene is really able to produce electronics that can be integrated everywhere, what we call ubiquitous electronics. And with this, I would like to conclude by highlighting that we believe that we are at the most exciting time for electronics in the last 30 years. And this is because of the combination of new materials such as gallium nitride or graphene and new technologies and new applications like flexible substrates, transparent electronics, etc. I hope this has been this talk has been a quick summary of some of the exciting devices, circuits, and applications that are going to come in the near future. Thank you very much for your attention. My email address is shown here in the bottom right corner of the slide, ppalacios@mit.edu. Feel free to email me anytime if you have any questions about gallium nitride, graphene, or the future of electronics in general. Thank you very much.
Very good, sir.
Great.